And I'm very happy to be here again in Cologne. It's always a great pleasure for me. And I almost feel at home here. We had so many discussions here, and so it's always a wonderful atmosphere, a wonderful logosphere. Thank you very much for the cozy atmosphere you created in that room. it's a very cozy thing, and I just want to use these 30 minutes over Winterland. You may know the Jefferson Airplane song, 30 Seconds Over Winterland. So it's not about 30 seconds, it will last 30 minutes. But I would like to introduce a little bit of trans-area thinking. 2 years ago or so, we organized a congress on New Orleans. And this congress was a little bit built around, we will hear much more about that tomorrow, around the idea that New Orleans is a kind of archipelago. So different islands in New Orleans and outside New Orleans that create the myth of New Orleans. Right? And so this archipelagic structure is, of course, a trans-area structure in the sense that it's not only in one given area, but it's a relational structure. So what I want to do today is the possibility to think in another vectorial dimension. So not to stress the relational, but to stress much more the vectorial dimension of this trans-area focus on a given city. This time it will not be New Orleans, it will be Tanger. And so this will be a little bit the scope of the whole of my parcours. And let me just say at the very start, I'm from the south. And you may add that it's the south of the north. That's true. My taxi driver here in Cologne yesterday asked me where I come from, and said I'm German, and he did it was a Turkish taxi driver, of course, and he did some kind of racial profiling, and said, no, you're not, you're from the south, and so it's true, it's a black forest, so the deep south in Germany. Trans-area studies are not about mappings that are reduced to a spatial dimension. They are about vectorial dimensions, dynamic dimensions. They are not so much interested in frontiers, they do not disappear, but in movement and crisscrossing through different frontiers. In that sense, trans-area studies create not kind of global dimension in first place, but a trans-areal, so the relationship between different areas. That creates not a static global vision, but a very moving, in every sense of the word, motion and emotion dimension of the object of our studies. At the same time, trans-area studies are based upon the simple, at first glance, very simple thing that literature is not about reality. It is about lived reality. And this is the difference. And you may find that even in Aristotle, art is total, as you can say in English. And in that sense, it's very important to understand that life is a kind of built-in in literature. And in that kind of dimension of living and knowledge on living, knowledge to how to know to survive, how to know to live together, is there from the very starts, from the different origins in the different literatures of the world. So of course there is an archipelagic structure in it with very different literatures of the world. Interrelated, not always, but in a way through a trans-historic dimension, they are interrelated. But at the same time, they offer us deep insights in the knowledge of life, for life, in life. And this is something that is extremely important to understand the foundational dimension of trans-area studies. Don't be afraid. I would talk not so much about theory, but I would talk about a given city, which is Tanger, in the north of the south. So please allow somebody from the south of the north to talk about the north of the south. And in that kind of crisscrossings, perhaps there might be a possibility not to territorialize continually what we are doing, but to see it in a dynamic sense as well. So kind of criticism beyond a given, what Hannah Arendt called nativität, so a nativity, but to put into motion and emotion the kind of crisscrossing we are doing. So in a sense, criticism without a fixed abode. I stepped into the circle of the walls around the city. There were the Turks adoring the sun. Then came the Muslims with the most beautiful places to live. And then the Chinese. And I settled down and I went to the Sultan, and there I saw this man I had met before in New Delhi. In that kind of anagnorisis, the eye says, but you're Al-Basri. We met in New Delhi, but you're from Tanger, aren't you? These are the words of the most famous Arabic traveler, Ibn Battuta, who started his traveling in 1325 with a Hajj, and who ended his traveling with another Hajj in 53. He spent all his lifetime, or most of his lifetime, he started as a young man, 22 years old, and he reached out from the extreme west of the Arabic world to the extreme east of the Muslim world. Of his time. So in China. In that kind of vectorial dimension, Tanger became a myth. A myth that was growing during all that kind of traveling. The farther he got, the more present was the myth. And it is, as the first chapter tells us already, about how we can live together in peace and indifference. It is about how we can live together, or we could say in English, it's not exactly the word, conviviality. We don't have the same word in English as in Spanish, convivencia. It's not exactly the same, and there's a wonderful passage written by Jorge Semprún about that kind of linguistic default, or that kind of missing link in our language, in English as well as in French, about this kind of living together. So Ibn Battuta is already there, and at the same time, so in China, and at the same time in Tanger. He gives us a sense about the things that happen in the Arabic world, and the informations are at the same time a kind of fuel for the whole traveling. Because this traveling is based upon information. Ibn Battuta collects all these informations based upon his eyesight and his ears, as in Greco-Roman antiquity as well. They are equal. And so it is of course, a wrong, we could have a wrong understanding of Ibn Battuta if we reduce him to modern Occidental conceptions of author, authorship, authority. Because his traveling is the itinerary structure, is the kind of structuring knowledge available in the 14th century of our era. And Ibn Battuta is quite aware of a lot of literatures out there, including as well the writing by Marco Polo. Ibn Battuta in that sense is kind of Arabic Marco Polo, but it is more structured knowledge about the differences in the different fields of Arabic and Muslim knowledge. So in that sense, as I said, the fuel is informations, and he is going to the Sultan sometimes, but just passing through very small routes. We could call in French routine. And it was a routine that was embedded in his own traveling to go to the sultans and to different sultans and to the local governments and to sell the informations that allowed him to continue traveling, giving, for example, some new informations about Constantinople, about the Arabic West, and so forth. In that sense, Tanger becomes the city of a traveler. And in that sense, Tanger becomes a transit city. In the reorganization of knowledge in terms of an itinerary structure, the vectorial dimension produces a certain continuity. This continuity, so the uninterruptedness of a given route, allows the routines of trying to translate the knowledge he is the owner of. And we will find that kind of translational process all along the story of Tanger. In that sense, Tanger in the extreme west and is praised as the place where the sun gets down at the latest moment. It is the extreme west of a route that was a circular route in the first place. So going back through Alexandria and the island of Java to Tanger, to that city, who was already in the center of the crossroads going from north to south and south to north, and of course at the entrance of the Strait of Gibraltar, where Hercules divided the earth. In that crossroads, there was the city built in the 5th century before our era by the Carthaginian people. And in that place, we had the relationships in a very long continuity. It's not about islands, it's about continents. It's not about discontinuities, as in the case of New Orleans. It's not about discontinuities, it's about continuities. It's the creation of a vectorial space that is characterized by these kinds of translational processes within that space. So, if we look how in the literatures of the world, this region is represented in the next century, we see that Leo Africanus, that was the source of our knowledge in the north about the south, in the sense of the knowledge stored in Rome upon upon Africa, until the best source, until the start of Mungo Park's collections of informations. Leo Africanus, born in 1492 or around 1492, so at the moment when the so-called, later so-called Catholic kings entered Granada on the 6th of January 1492, he was a traveler who had known exile, being expelled by these kings to the north of the south, on the other side of the Strait of Gibraltar. So in the in-betweens again, between Jebel al-Tariq and Jebel Musa. So in the two parts that are the two cornerstones for the division between north and south. Leo Africanus is from the north, and he gives us information about the south, and he will be the author of the south for the north. He will write down, when he is captured and given as a slave to the Pope, who will give him his name. So Leo Africanus, of course, is the Pope Leo, the one with Martin Luther, you know, had to deal with. In that sense, he will be, Leo Africanus, will be the author of the invention of Africa. And again, we have the continuities created by a traveler. The continuities of the different travels through Africa, through the sub-Saharan Africa as well, and going back to Cairo and to Constantinople, and the whole relationships between the south and the north. His Geographia will be published 25 years later, in 1550, as a part of Viaggi e Navigazioni by Ramusio, in that center of informations that was the town of Venice, a town created or based upon different islands, an archipelagic town. But this is a different story. The archipelagic book of or collection by Ramusio shows us a work that allows us to think when Tanger and other cities of the north of the south as part of a continuous work in relationship between in a continuous relationship between north and south, being towns like Alexandria some of the hot spots in that kind of north-south relationships. Of course, at the same time, 1492 Annus Mirabilis, we have the so-called discovery of the New World. And so the entrance of globalization in that close Mediterranean part of the world. On March 15, 1493, Columbus came back with his fellow travelers, and syphilis appeared. In their sexual hunger, it spread all over the place very quickly. And so syphilis is, in the first period of accelerated globalization, is one of the markers, the globalization markers, we have in all these different periods of accelerated globalizations, until the AIDS and the Ebola viruses the fourth period of accelerated globalization, which is ours, coming to a still stand right now. In that context, so we see in which sense Leo Africanus is creating a world that is globalized. Syphilis in Norway is attributed to the Scots. The Scots attributed to the English. The English attributed to the French, de morbo gallico. Syphilis for the Arabic world is attributed to the Jews. So in that sense, we already have a very continuous othering of the dangers of globalization, all these catastrophes that come with globalization, but at the same time, the changing of the marketplace in Alexandria, very well described by Leo Africanus. So let me make a difference. We had two periods right now, on the 14th century and at the 15th century, and now I would like to do a step to the mid 20th century and the late 20th century. In this kind of gap, I could fill in, but this would ask me to do that for more than 30 minutes. We have all these wonderful writers for which Tanger, in a very long story of colonial powers possessing Tanger, talking about the Portuguese for one century, the Spaniards from 1580 for one century, and the British, and then the internationalization of the city of Tanger because of the strategic, the geostrategic position it occupies at the entrance or the outlet of the Mediterranean. We have these wonderful writers as Burroughs, as Kerouac, as all these writers that Truman Capote, that come through city that is has always been a transit city. So TransArea transit city, Tanger. A man is sitting on the bar. He closes his eyes. There's a soundscape. I want to hear and see the sounds of different languages, the sounds in Arabic, the sounds in English and French. I want to hear the sound in a tea, of a spoon, in a teacup with green leaves. And I want to see that there is pas de phrase. It's figure 33 in Le Plaisir du Texte by Roland Barthes. The creation of an inner soundscape is inverting the kind of transitional position of Tanger. Tanger is not expanding, it's coming. Continuous conversation from people coming from other places. In a given room that is inside and outside at the same time, like Jean-Luc Nancy defines what we can hear. It's inside and outside at the same time. In a given spot between the ears is the creation of a whole world. A whole world built up by different languages. No possibility to understand all these languages. But there is a bruissement de la langue. There is a continuous sound that is creating. Figure 33 is, of course, alluding to Severo Sardui. Severo Sardui, who had published a text on Tanger in 1971. This text on Tanger was written in Spanish, or let's say in Cuban. And it was translated by the people of the Revue Tel Quel by Philippe Solers. And from the very start, the different languages are there. The Cuban is there in a French text. The English is there. The Arabic is there. In that kind of multilingual dimension, the text quoted quoted like Barthes did his quotations, created by Severo Sardui, is creating an inner landscape, a soundscape that is creating Tanger as an island. There's an island, of course, related to Paris. an island that is based upon the travelings done by Roland Barthes, who visited very often the place together with Michel Foucault and with so many other French intellectuals. Tanger became a crossroads for French theory, and not only theory. It was not the place of a noli me tangere. Of course, this kind of sexual relationship was based upon an archipelagic structure, a non-continuous, a discontinuous traveling. Already in SZ, Barthes has said that the challenge would be to create a travel narrative without traveler, a travel narrative without itinerary structures. And so the discontinuous is based upon kind of dépossession de l'Occident, depossessing the Occident. Pas de phrase. So figure 33 is called phrase. And the breaking with the phrase means breaking with the continuity. So the challenge is bringing the North to the South in order to transform the South, to transform the North in the South. And in that sense, Tanger, again, is the place where the translations take place. Ainsi donc is giving us, from the very title, that kind of discontinuity that creates the relational structure. The vectorical structure is gone. It's away. And Barthes, in that sense, in Ainsi donc, is creating three different islands on the continent in Morocco: Tanger, Rabat, and in the south, Marrakesh. Between these islands, all the time, movements, but discontinuous movements. In that sense, Tanger seems to come pretty close to the mise-en-scène of New Orleans. But in that sense as well, we can see in which sense the Occidental discourse becomes broken and opens again on the North. But the North seen from the South will not be the same North again. The translational process changes Paris. The translational process in the late part creates a different world. The North and the South meet in the North of the South. And the different islands are all around the Zoco, all around the center, the historical center of Tanger, are just co-present in a trans-historical way. Tanger is a literary city, of course. And I just mentioned all these very important authors came to Tanger in the late 40s or in the 50s, who came to Tanger even in the 60s, as we have seen. Tanger was the dreaming point for refugees as well. As Casablanca, during the Nazi government, Tanger was the way to escape the hell. So in that kind of paradise, there's a last text I would like to allude to, published in 1999 by a Guatemaltecan writer, Rey Rosa, Rodrigo Rey Rosa, La Orilla Africana, the African shore. It all starts on the shore, La Orilla Africana, with the sheep, with the currents, with the air, with everything that is on the move. All these dangerous currents in the Strait of Gibraltar. It starts with the shepherd, with a young Moroccan shepherd and a sheep. It's a relation between the animal and the man. And there is something that reminds us the Gilgamesh epos. a Gilgamesh epic that in the figure of Enkidu shows us and brings us to us the kind of how to live together with animals. So in that kind of bringing together these different logics, we have from the very first moment a kind of transhistorical way to see, to bring in all these different perspectives, including the transatlantic. There's a kind of triangle between the protagonists, the most important protagonists in that novel published in 1999. It is written a little bit like in Barthes' sense by écriture courte. So it's a small a kind of écriture, 55 chapters. And some of these chapters can be considered as microtexts, as narrations in a very short way, short fiction. In these 55 very short texts, we have the multiplication of vision, of perspectives. There are different truths coming from these three different perspectives. I will very shortly explain. The different truths don't mean that we cannot distinguish between truth and a lie. So it's not about alternative facts. It's about the creation of truth from different perspectives at the same time. It's to integrate, in a sense, the vectorial and the relational point of view. The three protagonists come from the spot, Morocco. They come from Colombia, so from Latin America, and they come from France. And these three different protagonists create a trans-aerial logic, which is characterized by a trans-historical dimension. So the young Julie is working on archaeology. She's working on the different layers of history and histories of movement. The roads that brought the lions caught in the deserts in the south through Tanger to Rome, to the circus. The roads that crisscross the north of the south leading to the north, or the south of the north. And in that relational structure, the three protagonists are continuously changing their places. The owl, that is one of the most important protagonists as well, so the relationship between the men and the animals, the human beings and the animals, play that kind of relational structure through. But it is a vectorial structure at the same time. La orilla africana is translational, even on the move. In a taxi, we see the Colombian protagonist talking in Arabic to the taxi driver. There is a story of what we could call the Arab-American dimension of that kind of relational structure. So Colombia and Morocco are directly translated into the other logics. And the polylogic structure embedded in La Orilla Africana is opening to a new understanding. This is already an invitation to listen what Taia has to say tomorrow on that novel, as I learned that he will talk about it tomorrow. But what I would like to try to transmit is that the relational structure is embedded in a vectorial. From the very start of the Gilgamesh epic, we have these travelings, the traveling through a space and through a given time. In that vectorial dimension, I feel literature is about what matters in life. It is a vision of life from a very different points of view. The global South is a South that we should ask, and this is what literature does, on the level of life, how we can live the South, and not so much about the frontiers of the South. Where is the South? Can we remap world literature? If we do so, should we do that in a kind of a spatial mapping? I don't think so. The example of Tanger, and Tanger as transit, as a worldwide transit, even before the first period of accelerated globalization from the north to the south, there were other periods before, because as a kind of pre-history of the globalization we know. In this, we see how the living together becomes difficult. All the relations in La Orilla Africana fail. All the kinds, the forms and norms of living together will lead to catastrophes. All the relationships will end. But there is the bird. The bird, the owl, La Lechuza, who will, at the very end, start again to fly. To fly over the ruins of European colonialism and to build her own home in a house by the sea. In a house where other birds are already living. All these different birds are brought together. The idea of the transhistoric dimension in the bird's flight is not already an Occidental, it's not only an Occidental dimension. There is a kind of translational process of the different meanings of the owl in Colombia, in Morocco, in France. Wisdom is only one possibility to see this. But the flight of the owl, the owl's flight, brings together the relational and the vectorial dimension. The owl's flight is like in Humboldt's parroquet, the one who still speaks the language of a, like the Atures, of a tribe, an Indian tribe, that has disappeared. The owl is like in Max Aub's concentration camp, the raven who sees the concentration camp from outside and sees the forms and the norms of the catastrophes of living together. And the owl is perhaps as well the Schneeeule, the owl of the winter in Cécile Weisbrot's Memorial. The owl's flight brings together what we can know about the possibilities to rebuild our world. A world that is not characterized just by clear spatial definitions, but by translational processes. These translational processes are based upon polylogic structures. The polylogic structures are trying to make us understand that literature is something about how we can learn to live together in order to understand, to think in different logics at the same time. In that sense, we can step into the city. We can see the Turks that adore the sun. We can come to the Muslims' quarter, the most beautiful, and we can see the Chinese people. We can bring together the relational to the continuous structure, and perhaps we can bring together as well the logics of the South that are logics of the North, and the North of the South to the South of the North. Thank you.